I mentioned that Joanna Brooks could not be here. She, of course, is the author of Book of Mormon Girl. That's done very well. We actually have some sale copies. We got it at a really nice price if you're interested in that. The book that you've all come to hear about tonight, Mormon Feminism, Essential Writings, Oxford University Press. But the editors are particularly excited to announce that it's already in its second printing, and we haven't even reached the publication date yet, which is it, November what?
Second.
November 2nd. So this really is not even here. It doesn't exist. That's pretty exciting when you can go into a second printing before the pub date. So that's a great thing that we just learned tonight. This represents the body of Mormon feminist writings for decades, literally. And it's an incredibly important book. Kathleen Flake had this to say: spanning the second wave to the present wave of the women's movement, these essays constitute a significant body of work on the religious implications of feminism. Their usual omission from feminist and Mormon history makes a collection of them here all the more welcome and necessary. They are indeed essential. The study of contemporary Mormonism should not be attempted without them. And Aline Clyde said, "The depth and breadth of Mormon feminist thought assembled in this volume will bring awareness to some and enlightenment to many. So much that has been thought and felt among Mormon women is here for reflection, reference, and discussion. This book will enrich the legacy we treasure and point us to a proud future." Of course, she was in the General Relief Society presidency a number of years ago. We getting it?
Yeah, we heard that.
Heard something. Static, which is usually what I'm really good at. Rachel Hunt Steenblik is a PhD student in philosophy of religion and theology at Claremont Graduate University. And she will be speaking to us first. Hannah Wheelwright is a programs assistant at Robert F. Kennedy Human Rights. Human Rights what?
That's the name.
It really is? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I thought maybe.
It's unfortunate.
Okay, because actually I saw a typo in the copy on the back of this too, so I wondered if maybe something got left out. Founder of Young Mormon Feminists and a former spokeswoman for Ordained Women. And then after our two editors speak to us, Linda King Newell, who I am proud and excited to say is a longtime friend of mine and a model for me in my life. I don't know if I've actually ever said that to you, Linda, but she's wonderful. She's brilliant. She's produced some incredible things over the years, including, I guess you could say, almost legendary now, Mormon Enigma, Emma Hale Smith, the biography of Joseph Smith's wife, Emma. Just real quickly, I will tell you that back in the day when I was still at Deseret Book, we had a signing at the main store, and Val Avery and Linda came to sign books, and back then it was on three levels, and the lower level was where the non-Mormon books were, and that's where we were holding the signing. And then the main level was the church book level, or the church level we call it, and then there was children's above that. And at some point somebody said, "Bring them upstairs to the church floor." Do you remember that, Linda?
Yeah.
It was so exciting to have the signing on the church floor. And I'm not making this part up, but on one occasion someone said, "Can you tell me what a Mormon enema is anyway?" And I said, "I could, but it would be really good." I said, "If you use coffee for it, make sure it's decaf." But anyway, so that really happened. But we're thrilled to I guess Linda will kind of stand in for all the contributors who are far and wide, and I guess some aren't with us anymore. Is everyone still?
Yeah, no, a few have passed, yeah.
Okay, a few have gone. So she'll kind of be standing in, as the our two editors are also contributors, have material in here. But we can't have everybody here, obviously. So Linda's going to talk about her seminal work, A Gift Given, A Gift Taken, that she told me the other day. I'm not sure I've actually heard her articulate this before, at least to me, saying that that was her most important work that she's ever produced. And I would have probably said this, but anyway, it's a thrill and a privilege for me to now finally turn the time over to our guest editors tonight, and we'll start with Rachel, and then Hannah, and then Linda, and then we'll answer your questions. Thank you so much. Did we ever get it done?
So as I mentioned, mine is the quiet voice out of Hannah's, and I, so I'll try really hard to speak loud. Please, if you're in the back, like, do something like this to let me know if I need to try a little bit harder. Thank you for the introduction. Linda is one of my heroes, too. I met her last night for the first time, and it felt like such a gift to be able to meet someone whose words have mattered so much in my life and in my actions. So the very, very first time that I heard about this project and this book was sitting in a room at my school, Claremont Graduate University. Joanna Brooks was the keynote speaker to a conference featuring many religions, and she was invited as a Mormon woman to speak about Mormon feminism as the keynote. She was the last speaker of the conference. She spoke right after I gave a speech on Heavenly Mother, and Caroline Klein, who helped start the Exponent blog, had spoken right before that on the changing language of family proclamation things and patriarchy and equal partners. And so as I'm sitting in the audience listening to Joanna, she talked about how Mormon women need a book, how the work of Mormon feminism has value, and that there's something about a book that conveys this value. And so she said that Mormon women who are coming of age, and I'd add Mormon men who are coming of age and of any age, that we need to hold in our hands the knowledge and the perspective of the last 40 years of Mormon feminism, to know that the questions that people are asking about gender in the church today, that these are not new questions, that they've been asked for many, many years by those who've come before. And there's something like slightly sad about this, that they still have to be asked, but something also really hopeful that we're not alone when we ask these questions. So I listened to Joanna say these and many other remarks, and I had no idea at that time that she was going to write me and invite me to be an editor with her. And so when I got the email, I was 6 months pregnant with my first child. I was struggling, very much struggling, to finish my last semester of my PhD coursework. And my husband and I were set, like, in just a few weeks to make what felt like a very brave move across the country from Claremont, which is near Los Angeles, to Brooklyn, New York. And as soon as I saw the email, first I thought it was fake. And then when I realized that maybe it wasn't fake, and I read it to my husband, and I said, "What do I say?" And he said, "Say yes." And I took all the courage that I could muster to, like, write back and say, like, "Yes, of course I would love to help you with this." Like, when I actually had no idea how this would be possible, how I would have the time, how I'd have the ability to participate in this work that meant so much to me. I was filled with so much, I felt so humbled and so honored at the same time. And I first met Hannah in her apartment in Provo when she was still living there. My family lives in Provo now. I grew up in Oregon, but I was visiting my family. And when Hannah and Joanna found out, we decided that we would meet each other there in Hannah's apartment and have our first Skype meeting with Joanna for our first official kind of kickoff of the book, of deciding, what does the word essential mean? What are we going to be looking for? What text? Like, what is our criteria? And Hannah will talk a little bit more about that in a minute. But so it was really, really important to Joanna to include cross generations. And so I am 15 years younger than Joanna, and Hannah is almost exactly 10 years younger than me. And so we don't represent, and the editorship at least, we don't represent women like Linda, but we also sought their advice and their wisdom. And so Joanna and I actually went to the Exponent retreat when it was their 40-year anniversary. And we were in charge of a workshop that was interactive, where we met with people of all generations, but there was a really large percentage of the founding mothers of the Exponent 2 that were there, including my professor and mentor and friend Claudia Bushman, Laurel, Thatcher Ulrich, Pulitzer Prize winner, Judith Dushku, and many, many others. And we showed them our first draft of our table of contents. Our first draft was a 1,000-page manuscript. So we said, look at this table of contents and tell us what we're missing. So Joanna put me in charge, and so it was pretty funny to have to call on people like Laurel and Claudia, and sometimes someone said we need to move on to the next question and listen to their answers, and they said, you need something by Chieko, you need Laurel's Lusterware, you need this, and to listen to their wisdom and their advice. And after we were finished listening to the texts that mattered to them, we said, now help us cut it in half, because that's our task. And so that was the next thing that we did together, that we tried to say how we could do this. And the way that we did it, we wanted to keep as many voices as possible. So what we have in the book is a very curated text where many, many of the pieces are truncated so that we can have as many different voices and pieces as possible. And so that we can point people to the pieces and they can read the whole text on their own. And so with that, we were able to have, we asked as many Mormon feminists in person and online as we could for their advice and their suggestions. And so what we did, we did a lot of work. We also had a lot of help. And it definitely felt like this community of sisterhood pulling together. And so we also, both of us are going to speak about kind of what the book meant to us personally and what was happening to us. So I mentioned that I was pregnant with my first child. She was 6 months in my belly, and now she's 2. She just turned 2 this month. And so we've been working on the book for that long, almost 2.5 years. And I'm now actually expecting my second baby, so it feels kind of full circle that this is the time that it's come. And so the philosopher I study, my friend Jacob, studies him too. His name is Soren Kierkegaard, and he has a book called The Works of Love. And one of them is about works of remembering, and his is specifically remembering those who have died. And so it is only a few of our contributors who have passed away, but it feels very much like remembering voices from the dust and remembering those people who have come before. So during this process, my heart has turned to my mothers. And it's felt so holy to remember their words and to be able to give space to them and to give recollection to remember together with Hannah and with Joanna these words that meant so much to our community. But it's also definitely been a heart turning to my daughter and to the posterity and to the future. So I've done it for those who've come before, and I've done it for myself, and I've done it for my daughter, Corinne, for the next baby, and for my nieces. I have one niece who is 10, and when her sister turned 12 and had to memorize the young woman's name in Young Woman, my niece, Azure, said, why do you even have to memorize that? You don't even get to say it, and started crying. And she started asking her mom, why is the church sexist? Is Jesus sexist? If he's not, why doesn't he tell his church? And so this is a 10-year-old child asking these questions. And so the first thing my sister did was call me, and she said, you talk to her, you answer her questions. And then one of the things that's happened, I said at the very beginning when I learned about this book, Joanna said, we need to hold something in our hands. We have blogs and we have podcasts, but they are not enough. We need something that will last and something that's physical and tangible and that can tie us together, that can reach across the generations. And the remarkable thing that's happened is people are doing it. That even without encouragement from us, people started posting selfies, holding their book and smiling, sometimes hugging it, sometimes like pretty intense looks in their eyes of gratitude or pain. And when my oldest sister sent me a picture of my niece who asked those questions, I started crying, because this is who, for me, the book is for. And so while it's a work of remembering and a work of love, it's also, some of it is work that is really heavy, and it's been a work of sacrifice and a work of exhaustion as well. So to be able to do this work, I've spent thousands of my own dollars to pay for babysitting time to do this work, and I've just spent so many hours. And I've said before how I've given my heart and my mind and all of my daughter's nap times to this project. And it was the biggest sacrifice I could give, but I would do it again because I love this community and I think this work does have value, as Joanna stated. And so one of the most precious things was the first day that I received my copy. It was actually General Conference Saturday, and I was taking a nap in between sessions while my husband was watching my daughter, and then I woke up to my little daughter snuggling beside me on my bed, So my first thought is to be frustrated at my husband that he let her come wake me up. But then my eyes are still closed and she says, "Mommy, read it, please." And I keep my eyes closed, thinking that it's just one of her picture books. And she says it again, "Mommy, read it, please." So I open my eyes and she is holding the book. And it took me a minute to realize what was happening, because I thought, how does she have that? How is this in her hands? But this book that I made for my daughter, she gave to me, that I wanted to give to her, she presented it to me. And it felt really precious as well. And I didn't ever say, "This is my book," but I think maybe my husband did, because now every time she sees a selfie, or anytime she sees a picture, she says, "Mommy book." And when one of the best, someone posted a picture of their cat with a book, and she said, "Meow meow, reading mommy book." And so I tell her that it is, that it's my book, but I also say, but it's much more than that. It's the community's, it's all of our book together. And I tell her that it's her book, because it is. And so it's been such a holy and harrowing experience to be able to do this. And there are many pieces in the book that caused some sadness in remembering them, some pain. But I don't think it's either a sad book or an angry book or a painful book, because there's something else that's true, that it's women telling their stories in their own words and their own voice. And in it, they ask their big and their small questions, and there's some power that comes from that. And so as they tell their truth, there's also healing, and there's also balm, and there's also hope. And this book carries its own power and its own strength. And so what I cry every time I read it, no matter how many times we had to read all of the different versions, it's still something so precious to me that gives me so much hope. And that I think that this is just one place to start. It's one book. We need many, many more to fill in the gaps. Ours is a literary history. We need different kinds of histories and different kinds of writings. But we are honored and grateful to be a part of this one. Thank you.
I wanted to talk a little bit about sort of the criteria that went into the book, particularly because the whole idea of having sort of a Mormon Feminism 101 book that we could hand to people, because Joanna had said that she was talking with young BYU girls who were saying, you know, "Oh, we're trying to learn about Mormon Feminism," and Joanna would say, "What are you reading to learn about Mormon Feminism?" And they would say, "Your book, The Book of Mormon Girl." And Joanna was like, "No. You can't, that's not enough. You can't just read my memoir and understand the history of this movement." And so that was where our project really began. And so I started, got involved in the project in June of 2013. And it was the beginning of the busiest summer of my life. I was a full-time student at BYU. I was working at the MTC. And I had just started a really demanding internship in Salt Lake. And I was also involved with this like nascent organization called Ordained Women. And we were trying to figure out what we were going to do. And I had also had, at this point, it had been a year since I had started the blog Young Mormon Feminist. So when I was then going to take on the project of working on this book, it was a little daunting because, like Rachel, I didn't really know how I was going to do it all when I said yes. But it had been really important to me when I had first come to the Mormon Feminist scene to acknowledge the work of the women who came before me. When I first had my sort of faith awakening, I Googled Mormon feminists and I saw that there was writing online, and I remember thinking, I'm not the first one that's asked these questions. I know that other people have talked about this. And so it was a little after that. In 2012, I attended the Women in the LDS Church Conference that the LDS Historical Department hosted. And that was the first time that I was in a room full of these very powerful women asking questions of the panelists that I was a little shocked to hear at something hosted by the church. But at that conference, I was able to recognize the work of these other women, and we definitely want to acknowledge that this is not the first book about Mormon feminism, and we certainly hope, and we know it's not going to be the last, because there's many other great ones in the work, but we absolutely want to acknowledge that there's been so much good work done, and this book is merely a compilation of beginning texts. But we, as we have here, I've seen Vicki Eastman is here, Maxine Hanks, and I'm sure we have many other folks who have contributed to this movement, and it's really important to us to honor and acknowledge the dedication that so many people poured into this movement who we couldn't even fit in the book. And so along with that, so I spent that first summer of 2013 in the basement of the BYU Library in the Special Collections section, because I was reading through the entire archives of the Exponent 2 magazine. And pulling apart these very like weathered old pages, and some of them were completely torn, so I was having to try to keep everything in place. But it was really one of the most holy experiences to sit there in the belly of the beast, as I called it at the time, and be reading these very edgy Mormon feminist writings. And I was very excited by them, and I was also very pained, because when you read through it just straight, not just one article at a time, but when you really page through Mormon feminist writings, especially because I was reading just the exponent too, I was able to see how people sort of responded, and they would write, you know, letters to the editor, and then you would see over time these trends. And so we were definitely looking for things that were essential, as we say, but specifically about pieces that were the first time an idea had been articulated a certain way, when something seemed to shift the dialogue or shift the conversation, that people read this piece and that changed how we thought about the topic. And so that was just some of our criteria that went into it, and it was very difficult because when I was reading the exponent, I would copy and paste it, and I transcribed a lot of things that didn't end up making it in there, and we did the same with many other books because there were so many pieces that were so important, and different people will have different pieces that they say, this changed my life, and somebody else says, oh, I didn't even hear about that, I didn't know that existed. And so the work of coming to a community that is as alive and vibrant and ongoing as ever is extremely difficult to then tease out what should be included in an anthology like this one. And we're very definitely excited by the conversations that we've had already, and I keep talking about in the next edition, we really look forward to, you know, to tweaking and to adding as much as we can. And I keep hoping that if I talk about a second edition enough, that it'll happen. And so I encourage you to join me in talking about the second edition of this book. But for me personally, working on it was extremely difficult. I was 19 when we started working on it, and definitely felt pretty inexperienced and unqualified to be gathering the words of so many incredible women. But at the same time, I was grateful because it's been an extremely difficult time in my life to go through BYU and the things I was involved in, and finding a job after college and driving across the United States, starting a whole new place, figuring out a lot of things. But throughout it all, being able to have this book as a constant and to be constantly reviewing the words of these women really was centering in a way that I don't know where I would be without it. But specifically, while I was at BYU and I was trying to figure out what to do after I graduated, I was in the BYU library, but one of the upper floors this time, and I was trying to study for finals, but it was extremely difficult, and I was not at all interested. Those final semesters at BYU were extremely, extremely difficult, because I was very, very, it was not a wise decision to leave the classes that I would hate the most to last. But as I was trying to rally my motivation, I remember sitting back in my chair and just looking around, and I was like, I'm a BYU, you know, would it really be so bad if I just married a rich husband, you know, what if I just, you know, looked for somebody with a little extra cash, and that way I could just do what I wanted to do, and I wouldn't have to worry about, you know, paying my rent and following my dreams. I could just have the dreams part, you know? And I remember I was half joking with myself, but I was also a little tiny bit serious in the, you know, the general feeling of it. But I remember that immediately I just felt this like rush of anger and fury and like outrage coming towards me, and just the words were just present on my mind, that is a cage. And immediately I was thinking of all of the women I had read, not just Mormon feminists, but all of the, I was a women's studies minor at BYU, and all of the other writings by women throughout history who have been trapped by having to rely on their husbands in such a, being truly trapped and having no other alternatives and not having it be a choice to be home or to be with a husband. And so I immediately was felt a little chastened by these dead people voices, I guess, coming towards me. But it sounds callous, but it's also, it's something that as much as I throughout time have, you know, questioned what is the spirit, or what is, you know, voices rising from the dust, and what is, you know, Mormon confirmation bias, and what is just me searching for a good feeling. And again, if I hadn't been working on this book, I think that I would have doubted myself and doubted what I felt and what I heard a lot more. But by working on the book, I've come to both acknowledge that I think there's cases where I might want to hear something, but I also have come to trust myself that what I've heard is not fake and what I've felt is not just, you know, a vent coming on and making me feel a little tingling, but are real things and are real emotions and are real words that people from the past are able to pass along to us. And that's part of why I think the book is so precious, is because all of these people who, yes, some of them passed on, Margaret Monk, Linda Silito, and I'm personally very grateful for both of their words. I am especially proud because I pulled their poems out of the exponent too, and they are now in the book. And it's such an incredible pleasure to be able to honor their words and to remember them. So that's a little bit about my experiences. So I'd like to have Linda come next.
Well, of all the beautiful and wonderful essays and poems and so forth that are in this book, I feel very honored tonight to be representing, in some small way, all of the work that has gone on by so many women, so many beautiful, strong women for so many years. Mentioning last night that I had my own experience with exponent, the first exponent, in the LDS Church library. They didn't have a full, a complete morgue of them. That's what those are called, or morgues, that Claudia Bushman found at Harvard. But I remember going through those pages that were so frail and on newsprint, as Exponent 2 was originally published on, in the same format, but experiencing exactly the same thing 35 years ago, in discovering for myself what was in the original Exponent. For those of you who aren't familiar with that, it was the precursor to the Women's Relief Society magazine. They had their own publication. They were in total charge of it. It was during, a lot of it occurred during the time that women were seeking the vote, and Mormon women were extremely active in that. And they were as outspoken as today's Mormon feminists are, while they were talking about the things that women can do and were doing and did do. They were good friends with the national leaders of the suffragette movement as well, and went to New York, some of them, and those leaders came here as well. But for my own essay, it's actually an excerpt from a larger essay, which is in this book. And if you don't know about this book, there's Linda Wilcox's Mother in Heaven essay is in here, and the one mine in here is called Gifts of the Spirit Women Share, and I deal with it a little bit more length than. And breadth than in the Sunstone article and the one, Linda Wilcox and I were giving these papers at a Sunstone conference very early on. And as we felt like that we knew we were breaking ground, we knew we were doing something that had not been done before, and as it ended and the applause settled down, people started to stir, and there were the whole group of us that were, most of us that were working on this book, the essays in this book, were sitting together, and there was this row of white-haired women, old women, in front of us, and. As the applause died down, one of them stood up. She's very tall. And she turned around and she looked along the row for a minute, and then she said, "I can die now, because you'll carry on." And it was Helen Stark, who was a very strong voice for women in the 20s and 30s. And it was, I'd never met her before that time. But as I have come across and met women like this group of women that have put this book together, and this whole other generation of Mormon women feminists, I feel the same way Helen did. I feel like I can die in peace because they will carry on, that what we did, 30 years ago, was not in vain, that our voices are heard. This book happened to be published at a time that there was a lot of nervousness in the church hierarchy about what historians, and particularly women historians, were saying, and a lot of kind of suppression verbally. And so I don't think that it reached the audiences that that this book will reach. Levina Fielding Anderson is one of the editors, along with Maureen Ersenbach Beecher. And Levina, by the time the book came out, had been excommunicated. So that meant that there were a whole lot of women that wouldn't touch it with a 10-foot pole. And the church had come down on Val and me for our writing about Emma Smith as well. But I just wanted to say just one thing about just a couple of things about how this particular subject became a passion of mine. And one day I walked into Leonard Arrington's office, and the Relief Society minutes, the Nauvoo Relief Society minutes, no one had seen them for, probably 100 years. And they found in the Joseph Smith collection at the church archives, they found a microfilm of them. And so as soon as someone discovered that, Leonard had them transcribed from the microfilm. And I happened to walk into his office the day that transcription was finished, and he just said, "Linda, you're going to want to see this." And I said, "Yeah, I am." And he let me take it. He said, "You can take it home with you, So he let me take it, and I had a typescript made of that, so that I didn't want to get Leonard in trouble if this showed up in my paper somewhere on the same typewriter. So rather than making a Xerox copy of it, I actually had it retyped. And a copy of that I gave to the library at the Reorganized Church. They did, the church finally gave them a copy of the Relief Society minutes on the microfilm. So they now have a transcript of that. And it's in my papers at the U, and Val's papers at Utah State. But it was in reading those minutes that it just first really hit me. I was aware that women were giving, doing blessings and things like that. But then at the end of the first meeting, Emma and her counselors blessed Sister Durfee for her health. And the next meeting, Sister Durfee stood and bore testimony that this was the best blessing, that she had been healed, and that this was the best blessing that she had ever received, even from the elders. And then Emma and her counselors did that on a regular basis. They blessed women for their health and for other needs. And this got kind of rumored around town of what was going on in the Relief Society, and some people started going to Joseph Smith. And he came back to the Relief Society and said that people had been wondering about this. And he said, "There's no more harm in a woman giving a blessing than wetting the face with water. And if the blessing should be realized, let all hold their tongues." And I thought, wow, what happened? Where did this go? So for the next 4 or 5 years, as I was still, you guys think you took a long time. It took Val and me 9 years to do Mormon Enigma. But during the next few years, every time I ran into anything having to do with women and spiritual gifts, I stuck them in a file folder. And then once Mormon Enigma was completed, I was able to move to this. And it's true. I think it is the most important thing I've written, because I think this can make a difference in a way that I think it can eventually change policy. I think that's not going to happen tomorrow, but this last week, the new white paper on women mentions Mother in Heaven, mentions women giving blessings. And I think that that is real progress, and I think that it will continue, those barriers will continue to be broken down. And at one point when Emmeline B. Wells, a young woman, asked her about this issue, you know, should women really be doing this? You know, they say that to call the elders and so forth, and she said, If you plant a plant and you keep poking at the roots, you're going to kill it. And that's exactly what they did. They just kept asking the questions until someone finally said, no, can't do it. And so I'm thinking that maybe instead of poking at the roots now, that we are watering the plant, and that it's going to bear fruit. And I'm grateful so much to all of you for the work you've done, and for all the women whose work they have collected, because I think that this is a new benchmark for Mormon women, and I thank you all.
I did not pay her to say benchmark at the very end. I swear. That's perfect.
Pun intended.
We've actually trademarked that name. Can't use it unless you're referring to us. Anyway, those were great presentations. We're going to have Q&A now. But I did neglect to mention that we had invited Margaret Toscano to speak tonight, and she's ill, having a rough time right now. So we were anxious to hear from her, but unfortunately that didn't work out. But I just wanted to acknowledge her as one of the contributors, one of the many contributors.
We've got Janice Allred.
We do have her sister here with us as well. Yes, she is. We've talked.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, she said she'd give me $100 to not call on her to talk. Okay, so let's have the editors come up and answer your questions. Hannah, do you want to just field those and direct me to pick people? I won't get in your way.
Yeah, we're happy to take any questions. And any contributors in the room as well, if you have a question for them, I'm sure someone might be willing to answer.
Yes,
thank
you. Well, as I've told you both, I really love this book, and I really love the commentary in between, which weaves all of these documents together. However, as the granddaughter of the last real general primary president, as I read about your talking about how the Relief Society had lost its budget, had lost its hospitals, had lost its publications, I hope, in the second edition, that you will mention that the primary women also ran hospitals, also ran publications, also did amazing things, and were also, all of that was taken away in correlation as well. Yeah. It wasn't just the Relief Society, and I think the primary was maybe more engaged in it than the young women. I'm not sure that the young women were engaged in those kinds of social services things,
right. Mm-hmm.
That the primary lost as well. So I just want to tell you that I wish you would put the primary in there too.
Definitely.
And just made a note.
Yeah, and we definitely welcome feedback like that. As I, my mom taught me a song about the primary children's hospital and donating a penny or a nickel.
Now, at one point, the somebody in church headquarters, instead of your, when I was a kid, you would, they have a little, they had a little box that they bring to primary that looked like the children's hospital you'd put pennies in on your birthday. And somehow those things, instead of going to support the hospital, were subsumed into the church general fund.
Wait, no, no, you are getting mixed up. Don't listen to him.
He's telling, I'm married to her. She has the right to do that.
No, he's telling a story about when I was in a primary presidency in California where we did not have the primary children's hospital, and so we asked our stake where the money was going that all we were sucking out of these little kids.
Right.
It was going into the general fast offering fund. So we called it Pennygate. But that didn't happen in Utah.
Certainly. Well, thank you. And definitely, there's absolutely things like that in the book that are left out, or we misspelled Sherry Patterson's last name, which I feel very bad about. You know, there's absolutely things in the book that need to be corrected, and so we're eager and anxious to make those.
So why don't you just do volume 2 rather than second edition?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely a question. I think that one of the, I don't have, there's no official answer. This is my spin on it. But I think that part of the difficulties of this work was especially covering like the most recent years, because it's very difficult to sort of write down history and weave it together as it's happening when it's so fresh and it's not necessarily clear which works are the more enduring and essential ones. And so I definitely think a second volume would be awesome, but I don't know how much time would pass before we would have a body of writing for a book. I mean, obviously, we could probably write it right now, and just the blog post of the last month could be in there, but I think there's more questions about the timeline.
You put the primary in, and some of the stuff that you put on the floor that you couldn't put in this one.
Mm-hmm. So a second volume of things that weren't in the first volume?
Yeah.
Plus editions.
Yeah. No, there's a lot of options, and I love your ambition. I look forward to it.
Would you do that?
Speaking of stuff you had to cut, are there any, like, special essays or authors that you really wish you would have been able to fit?
So many. Well, and like Rachel had mentioned, our first draft of the manuscript was over 1,000 pages. We had to cut it by over 60%, because Oxford said that the book had to be under a certain amount of pages, and we also wanted it to be at a reasonable price, so that it wouldn't be, you know, prohibitively expensive. So there are a lot of pieces. I'm trying to think of specific ones. There were definitely, there were sometimes different topics where we felt like there had been a lot of different really influential pieces on the topic, and we wanted to include all of them, but it became a question of which one do we put in. On the way over here, Rachel and I were talking about how we included Chelsea Shields, her essay or her
Dear
article,
Mom.
I guess, called Dear Mom, that was put on the Exponent blog, but we had also really wanted to include Lynette Taylor's article, Why I Don't Believe in Heavenly Mother, from Zelophehad's Daughter. So this is one example of we were having to decide, and we ended up feeling like Chelsea's was a little stronger, was a little more enduring, and so we ended up including that, but Lynette's piece was also really influential to a lot of people, and so it was articles like that that we kept coming across.
I'd say that there are also whole topics sometimes.
Yeah.
Like one of, we don't have anything about sister missionaries and definitely nothing about the age change, but I think that's a small and simple thing that will have huge bearing on Mormon feminism. And Hannah mentioned her first introduction to Mormon feminism was Googling, like after she's at BYU and having some of these questions. And she said a little bit more previously that it was actually in reading the Bible and reading about Eve and Adam's relationship that she had these questions about gender equality in the church, that she went to God and brought them forth in prayer. And so for me, it was on my mission, like seeing every day having 19-year-old boys call me and tell me what my goals should be felt really awful. And so it was also the fact that they had these leadership opportunities that I would never have. And just wondering if I had the same authority to teach that they did when I didn't know that I could give my investigators healing blessings when they needed help, that we had called the elders and they would come. That I couldn't baptize the people that I taught that wanted to be baptized. So wondering if I had the same authority to teach when I received the same mission call. And I've talked to many other people since that experienced some of this as well. And so it's a whole topic that I think is really important. And we do try to include it in the additional resources. I think the additional resources section is one of our most important pieces of the book, that we include other tools like a glossary, the index that Hannah and I labored over for many hours late into the night.
Please use the index.
Yeah.
Just take a gander. Just have some fun. So you use that.
But so I think that there are things that we couldn't include, but that we try to at least give nods to. Maxine Hank's work is so, so vital. We couldn't include her whole book. We wish we could have. We're able to include some pieces that she was able to include as well. She gave us good advice that we tried to follow. We were grateful for her input. And so there are so many things that we couldn't keep, and it was heartbreaking.
Yeah, Devin, back.
Just so you know, Signature probably wouldn't have made the cut.
Noted.
Signature probably doesn't have made you cut it.
You see just a second edition, or in light of the material, you see a second volume where maybe you would publish this other?
Yeah, that's where I don't know. Publishing. I don't know what the best plan would be. I just keep talking about it because I think that there needs to be more and better. And I think that by sort of considering this book not as like, this is the seminal, this is the only, like, you got it now. You hand the person this book, they'll know everything there is to know about Mormon feminism. They don't need to know anything else. You know, they're good to go for the rest of their life. I just feel like if we, the book needs to be treated as a aggregation, as a gathering together of these works, but that will continue because the community and the movement and Mormon feminism are, like I said earlier, vibrant, living, are growing, and so we need to both take a look at what we've written because it was just a first putting together, and we're very proud of what we've accomplished. We're very excited for what we've been able to put together with the help of so many people, but we're excited to make sure that what we are continuing to write, continuing in that tradition of Mormon women writing and thinking and being thought leaders, especially with the new essays that Linda mentioned that have come out, they're quoting the work that Mormon feminists did, and so now it's on the church website. So I think that there just needs to be more. So that's why I keep talking about a second edition. But again, I have no actual plans. Oxford has not said anything to us, so I'm just saying those words because they're cool.
There is one right by him, Maxine, and Maxine second.
Yeah.
It's an impossible choice. There is so much feminism in art history. I just want to say a couple of things. I was so impressed with the brilliant solution that Joanna and you all came up with, because I struggled with that same question. I mean, I read every Exponent, Exponent 2, Dialogue Sunstone, Mormons for ERA, every publication. I spent 7 years, and it was Linda Newell's session at Sunstone that inspired me to. So we've come full circle. It was 31 years ago that inspired me to collect that collection for Women in Authority. But it was impossible. It was impossible, and so I'm so grateful that this book has been done to go back and pull together pieces of feminist work, and the brilliant solution of just doing excerpts, because I struggled with that, and I thought, I can't include all this work, and Joanna brilliantly thought, well, let's just do some excerpts. What an idiot. But I went a different direction with Women in Authority. I went in a direction of focusing on theology. And so I love this book because it brings together the groundbreaking feminist pieces, the feminist history aspect. Mm-hmm. And I'm so happy to have another book that has the F word in the title. It has been so long. I think there are only two. I don't know.
Yeah,
Linda talked about this to us last night. So. But she was nervous when she saw the title.
Because my generation, I thought, okay, so there's going to be a whole lot of people that will not even look at this.
Yeah.
But they're my generation. They're going to die soon. it's an okay term now. It's okay to have it on the cover.
It was hard. Okay, it was dangerous to use the F word. It was dangerous. And we have another book with the F word on the title.
Yeah.
But thank you for your work, and
thank you for yours.
I'm grateful, and ditto to everything Linda said, ditto to everything you all said. I love you.
Thank you. I love you too. I want to add one comment.
Yeah.
Maxine's reminded me of one of the things that I love so much about the book. She talked about how it's not just theology, it's not just this, that what it looks like is actually really different from piece to piece, that some of them, Hannah mentioned poems that she called from the woman's or the Exponent too, but there's also when Mary Bradford was the first female dialogue editor, she gave a place for women's personal stories to matter, so the personal essay became a big genre. for Mormon feminist writing, and we see that in the blogs as well. But I think it's one of the reasons Mormons are such big bloggers, in the Bloggernacle and even Mommy Blogs, that we have this history of Mormon women and men we write. Mm-hmm. And so we tell our stories, and this is what we can do. So sometimes it looks like a personal essay, sometimes it looks like a poem. Sometimes it's Margaret Toscano's very academic writing, Janice Allred's very academic writing, and all of them are so important, and together they tell our story and show the medium that we've used over time.
Yeah. We'll go in the back, and then over here. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Do you know if Deseret Book and or the BYU Bookstore will be carrying it?
The BYU Bookstore has it.
Has it, and we're going to sign them tomorrow.
We're so happy.
Sorry?
I don't know about Deseret. Might not be in the Mormon section, but they will be in the religion section.
Yeah, and they told us, when we emailed them to ask if we could sign their stock, they said that they had 12, they originally ordered 12 copies, but that 7 of them had already been purchased. We're hoping that they have some stock for us to sign.
We're all alumni. Joanna, yeah. Hannah, and I are all graduated from BYU.
So we're excited to return to our roots. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm curious, you have a lot of fans here. I'm wondering about the breadth of reaction beyond, the core group that obviously supports quite a bit. I'm just curious to know if you've heard the varying reactions to this book.
Yeah. Do you mean like outside the Mormon feminist community?
Yeah, because obviously we appreciate it within our community.
I'll give the first answer.
The outer rings and what the chatter is out there.
So there are two main reviews that I know of so far. One is in the Publishers Weekly, where they gave it a really strong review, mm-hmm. and talk about how we have argued cogently that Mormons and feminisms can. Like, Mormons can be feminist and vice versa, but they just say a few other things. They do praise our index, so we really liked that part. the fun thing about that, though, so I studied library science for my master's, and one of my library school friends, she lives in Texas now and is a public librarian but in a children's library, and the first time we heard about this review, she sent me a copy of it. And there were some notes on it, and she told me that she didn't see it first, and she doesn't even have the say because she's over children's. But after one of her coworkers, who is not LDS, read this review, they ordered the copy right there for their public library in just this town in Texas. And so she thinks that it will be in a lot of libraries, like, for that reason, and that it's going to be a resource for many people who are not even LDS. Yeah. And then we have also received another really beautiful review from a theology professor who I believe is of the Lutheran tradition, and I was so grateful for her words, because she starts off and she links to each of these, but she talks about how there's criticism for all of the faiths and religion. So she says, you can't be a Jew and a feminist, you can't be a Muslim and a feminist, you can't be a Catholic and a feminist, just that these are things that people say. And she says it about Mormonism, and then she goes on to answer how that's not the case and how we can. And then she also just does such a beautiful job saying that the questions that we address and that are addressed by our contributors in this book, there are so many of the similar questions that all women of faith that are feminists, that they are asking the same questions. And so she feels like there's so much use in having these dialogues together and learning from each other, how we approach it and how we answer it. So those are two that we know of.
Yeah, I would say I've definitely had some people ask about why there wasn't more pieces from... for example, a conference talk or a devotional talk by a general authority that was, like, encouraging on women's issues or something like that. We've definitely had a lot of questions. Or, for example, Mary Stovall Richards and whoever the man was that she coordinated with on that, they wrote together, I can't remember his name, maybe Kent something, but it was called Feminism in the Light of Jesus Christ, and they were at BYU, and it was all about how the gospel of Jesus Christ is feminist and laying out their argument for that. And that's another example of an article that is really well done. But specifically in the book, a lot of what we were paying attention to was the community of Mormon feminism. And so how you define that community, or how you define, what should be included, it's difficult. For example, the interview with Chaco is in there. And, was Chaco Okazaki part of the community, or was she just an influential part of it? I think that there's varying ways to approach it, and we don't pretend to have a precise formula. But that's one thing I have heard, is people wondering why more pieces like that, not so much like in the mainstream Mormon feminist community, but sort of in and around it, weren't included. But I think for most people, that hasn't been like a point of contention so much as wondering about what's really in the book and how you describe it.
It didn't make the cut.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of so many things didn't make the cut, but there will be a lot more books, including those as well, I hope. Yeah.
I'd like to get Janice's thoughts on things that have happened the last few years, women praying in general conference, more young women going on missions, books like this. What are your thoughts on what you've seen change here in the last few years and what you might want to hope for in the future?
Good question.
Why don't you stand
up? Oh, okay.
Janice, can you repeat it for those in the back, best you
sure.
can?
Sure. I'll come up here. So his question is about how do I feel about some of the things that have happened recently, women praying in general conference, what are some of the other ones?
Young women missionaries.
Young women missionaries.
The women leaders sitting on the stand.
Women leaders sitting on the stand. To me, these are signs that the general authorities are aware that women have concerns and issues, but for me, it's not enough. If you know my work, I come from a theological perspective. For instance, there's the article that just came about the Heavenly Mother. And I say, okay, the problem with this is it doesn't take us any further than the proclamation of the family. It simply gives us, you know, the mother in heaven. The work that I've done has tried to show, ask the question, is the mother in heaven a member of the Godhead, and try to answer that. The church has made it clear that women will not be ordained to the priesthood. And to me, there can't be equality if women are not ordained to the priesthood. So I see these things that are happening as positive in the sense that they are listening to women and saying, yes, we see that you have concerns, but I still have my reservations because I don't think that they are addressing the most basic and serious issues which lead to the inequalities. And if you're interested, there's this book, Voices for Equality. I have a chapter in it called, LDS Gender Theology, A Feminist Perspective. And so I deal with those issues in there. If you're interested in that one, you can buy it here too. and that one, I sort of lay it on the line, why I think that we have the problem of inequality in the church. And to me, it goes right to those two issues, priesthood and mother in heaven. If the mother in heaven is not a member of the Godhead, we don't have equality. If women cannot be ordained to the priesthood, we don't have equality.
We don't have salvation.
Exactly. Exactly.
She makes it pretty strong.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else? We have one in the back. Sarah?
Yeah, I was wondering for each of you if there are particular pieces or even themes from the whole book that are just like especially meaningful to you. Because I love reading the book.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Do you want to go first?
Yeah. I think that for me, I think I had sort of different favorites from when we were working on it and then when I held the book in my hand, which surprised me a little bit. When we were working on it, obviously, as I mentioned, the poetry was particularly groundbreaking, both, because... especially, was it Lisa Bowen Hawkins who wrote Let My Sisters Do For Me, and was talking about, and the poem is about, you know, sister, like, let me see your unwashed clothes, let me see your dirty kitchen, you know, open up your door and let's be sisters together and let's embrace these things instead of sort of trying to present this totally put together, you know, everything's going perfect, but instead to find sisterhood in those sort of everyday trials. And that was one piece that reading it resonated so much with my experience with Mormon women and finding acceptance and unity as we just simply acknowledge our own faults and each other's faults and our shortcomings and our limitations. And then additionally, later on in the book, we include a piece by Trine Nelson called Claim Yourself, Finding Authority and outside of the institution. What is it? Finding acceptance outside of the institution. And so she writes about, you know, not needing to have the people in power accept and validate you, but that you yourself validate yourself and you and your community work together and build through your relationships and through the people you love and those around you, but that you build a community that is whole and that is working together and not simply just sort of, you know, aiming towards the top. And that was really important for me because even though I still absolutely stand by the work I did with ordained women, and I absolutely believe that women need to hold leadership roles in the church. It's also about turning inwards and looking at our community and towards each other for leadership and claiming that empowerment for ourselves. And I think that that's an important work that Mormon Women will continue to do even more now with the essay that kind of talks about women exercising priesthood authority, which apparently is the church's position now. So I'm very excited for more and more women to embrace that. Yeah.
Linda, so I'm going to answer that question too. Mm-hmm. So of the essays that I had read before, in part thanks to Maxine Hanks, both Linda King Newell's essay and Linda Wilcox's essays were so valuable to me. And Linda Wilcox's essay on Heavenly Mother, it was one of the very, very first things I read after I was hired by a BYU philosophy professor named David Paulson to research full-time after I graduated from BYU on Heavenly Mother. And so much of the research that I did went into the article for BYU Studies of Mother there, which, as Hannah mentioned, the essays that just came out, they referenced the work that Mormon feminists did. They referenced the work that I actually did. And so reading Linda's words for the first time and realizing how much more there was, because that was one of the very first things that I think I just started at LDS.org, and there was something like 6 references, and then I typed in Heavenly Parents and it was many more. But then I found Feminist Woman Housewives for the first time by just Googling it in general. But then realizing that there were so many things that were out there and so many quotes, I had so much more hope. So it was such a tiring time to do that full time, but it was such a healing time too. And I felt so full. And then Linda King Newell, she talked about how she thinks that her article that we have in the book is the most important writing she's done because it has the power of faith in Jesus Christ and for my love for her as her mother, the things that I saw in her and that I hoped for. And so Linda has changed my life with her article. And I've been able to witness other women exercising their spiritual gifts too, and I think so much of it is owed to Linda. And then one of the articles that I read for the first time while working on the book was Laurel Thatcher Oryx's essay, Lusterware. And there's this one great, great part where a young woman is writing her and saying something like, I used to think the church was 100% true, and now I think it's just 10%. Like 10% true. And Laurel said, like wrote her back and said something like, if you find any organization on earth that is at least 10% true, cling to it all of your heart. And then she said, 10% is probably too high. But I just remember, like, it was both funny but also so, so hopeful. And I think I just, like, sobbed as I read this. And then later, it also talks about her standing at this river, the Susquehanna, and feeling this outpouring of the Spirit. And having a little bit of knowledge of Laurel and being in Boston, and I was in the singles ward at the time, and my friends would text me whenever she taught Sunday school, so I would go to 2 wards that day. So having Laurel share this kind of testimony, which was very different than the types of things she would normally say, was so powerful too. And those are just in the first chapter, I think. So there's so many pieces that are so meaningful to me.
Yeah.
I'm a non-female feminist, but I'm also a scientist. As a scientist, you have people say all the time, if we can put a man on the moon, why can't we eliminate poverty, solve violence, etc.? The difference between hard science and the social sciences is that hard science builds on what has gone before. The relevance of that is that I remember listening to Vicky fulminate about coming back from a Sunstone symposium where some of the younger women were talking about some of the things they had just discovered that Vicky had known for years. She said, what's the matter with these guys?
I didn't say that.
I think you need a place to stay tonight?
It's a long drive home. Anyway, it was upsetting to her that some of these younger women had not discovered what she already knew. And I think what your book has done is it's done what a lot of foundational books in science have done, is it gives a foundation and a place to start for people who don't know some of the fundamental things. And as you know, I welcome that. Thank you for putting that together for people like me who weren't involved at the beginning either.
Yeah, absolutely.
You're welcome. And thank you.
Yeah, that's something like I mentioned, it was very important to me. I remember at that Women in the LDS Church conference I mentioned, I heard Amy Evans Hickman, who was the editor of the Exponent 2 at the time, I heard her introduce herself to someone, and I just sort of like stepped over and awkwardly stood by her while she finished her conversation and then just said, "Hi, I know who you are. I just started this blog, and I just want you to know that it's really important to me that we work together and that I acknowledge that these issues are not new and that we are able to help build on it." And still, I still think it's important to provide a place where younger Mormon feminists and younger Mormons are able to think about these things, because sometimes there's pressure with the bigger blogs because somebody does come in and say, "Oh my gosh, I found out about that 30 years ago, and this is what happened, and this is what I did," but that person is still experiencing it for the first time. And so I think it's that balance of honoring that experience and honoring how that person is dealing with this idea or the ramifications, but also surrounding them with the love and with the knowledge. And I think having the book is a really good example of having something physical that they can turn to when the internet's a really big place. I mean, I had mentioned, and this kind of goes along with it, I had mentioned that my favorite pieces in the book changed from the time I was working it to afterwards. And the reason for that is because it was very painful to have a physical sort of vault of all of the pains and frustrations and unanswered prayers or questions, because it's so hopeful and it's so, there's so much wisdom and beauty in the book, but there's also, to me, a lot of resonance that these questions have been asked for 40 years, and asking for more and wanting to be involved, and has made some changes, but not to the extent that we'd like. So it's also painful in a way. But yeah. Did you have a question?
Yeah, I just wanted to say I haven't read the book that Jeff Frank just told me about it. I'm from Southern America. And to me, feminism is completely different to what you are talking about. But I appreciate that you have read that education, that so much that, you know, like you're working on your PhD, you went to so many places. I admire you for that, for all the knowledge that you get, and for all what you put in your book. I have my daughter, she's going also to for a PhD right now. And I know how much you have to work for that. And but I'm a convert. And here I see you. And I'm just taking the little crumbs from you. And I just feel that, you know, all what you do is so much, it's great. And I hope that we can, in South America, we also can do those things, but at the same time, we have to start with that. We cannot go and say, "Hey, I want the Christmas," when we don't even know why can Heavenly Father bless me. So that is what we will get. And to me, that is so important.
Thank you so much for sharing. Yeah.
Okay, maybe a couple more.
Yeah. Can you reflect on what would be the difficulties of translating the book to Spanish? Because there are so many Latter-day Saints who that's their only church language.
Yeah, we're definitely interested in trying to make more accessible versions. We did ask Oxford about an audio version that would also be helpful. So, they said that they're working with their team on that. But as far as translating the book, it would definitely be a big endeavor. But we absolutely, I know that there's Mormon feminists, I know some who do translate even professionally, and so it's definitely something that ideally we would have it translated into other languages and be able to incorporate more writings from women from around the world. We do have a few from American Samoa, but for example, but it definitely needs to be more. So it's absolutely something we're considering.
Is there a Kindle edition?
There is a Kindle edition.
Great.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. I think this gentleman... Mm-hmm.
That was actually kind of my question, too. If in your research you saw enough material to do, like, a Mormon Feminism's book at some point in the future.
World.
There's world. If you choose any small topic from Mormon Feminism, there's the whole series of books that could be written about it, I think. But, yeah.
I do think, also tying into the beautiful comment back there, that there are a lot of voices represented in the book that we have, that there isn't just one Mormon feminism shown. So today you saw peaks of our Mormon feminism, you saw peaks of Linda's. But Kate Kelly, who was recently excommunicated, she has a piece in there There's also a piece by Nyland McBain, who worked for Bonneville Communications and helped run that and start the I'm a Mormon campaign. So we have very, very different perspectives, even within the book that we have, and people are coming from different places. And we also have Gina Colvin from New Zealand, and who, so there, we try to have as many voices as we can, and so it does represent some of these different Mormon feminisms, but it's definitely not enough. It's just one start.
Thank you so much.